There are people alive now who were born when the idea of flying was the stuff of science fiction. Today, travel through the solar system may seem just as fantastic. But could our children live to see an age when the impossible once again becomes routine? Over the years, science fiction has imagined every corner of the universe, yet we know only a fraction of its mysteries. Tonight, we'll reveal the technology that will take us to the stars, and how scientists believe they may have found a way to make the ultimate trip, not through space, but through time. The journey that ends with mankind's greatest fantasy starts with the challenge of the moon.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Lift off on Apollo 11.
In July 1969, the human race set out on its greatest adventure, the ambitious project to put astronauts on the moon. It had taken 8 years to achieve Kennedy's dream, but in their imagination, mankind had been there for decades. Back on Earth, generations of science fiction writers were vindicated, none more so than the legendary publisher Hugo Gernsback.
Anything you can think of that is being done today in the space age, we have done before in some way or another in my former magazines.
In these popular magazines, Gernsback's writers had created the future. But the accuracy of their vision was no coincidence. They'd based their creations on the ideas of scientists from around the world. In Russia, for instance, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky had developed many of the principles of modern spaceflight. Working in virtual isolation, he anticipated liquid fuels, multi-staging, and even space stations. But could any of the ideas depicted in his notebooks be turned into reality? It was an American named Robert Goddard who took the first practical steps in the adventure that may yet take us to the stars.
As I see it, in the next 20 to 30 years, we'll have a base on the moon and we will have visited Mars.
Nick Argento, historian and model rocketeer.
Well, this is Worcester, Massachusetts, the home of the rocket pioneer Robert Goddard, who launched the first liquid fuel rocket in 1926. And he inspired me as a youngster and continues to inspire me, particularly when you think that the rockets today which we launch are no different than the first rocket he launched 70 years ago.
And this is it, the site where Goddard launched the first liquid-fueled rocket. Launched 41 feet straight up in the air and 184 feet downrange. It landed right about here, which at the time was his Aunt Effie's cabbage patch. Today, it's a golf course. The missiles are being launched horizontally.
The experiments continued, but few people seriously thought that rockets would get anywhere for a very long time. Even science fiction visionary Arthur C. Clarke was skeptical.
Well, I knew in the 1930s that space flight was possible, but I never imagined it would be in my lifetime. In fact, I used to have a lot of arguments with my engineering friends, including Val Cleaver, who developed the first British rockets. They thought I was wildly optimistic. And in a sense, I was. No one could have predicted the political reasons that drove us into space.
And it was political conflict that transformed the rocket. In 1944, a desperate Nazi war machine turned to rocket scientist Wernher von Braun. Using slave labor in secret bunkers in eastern Germany, von Braun's team developed the V-2, a rocket that many Allied scientists considered impossibly advanced. But while von Braun's rockets devastated London, there is evidence that he had less sinister uses in mind.
Well, von Braun was a science fiction reader all his life. I think probably that's how he came to be involved in the original German Rocket Society. And when World War II came along, he didn't want to give up his continuing acquaintance with what was happening in American science fiction. So he arranged for a subscription to Astounding to be sent to a mail drop in Sweden and then forwarded to him. But I don't think he ever missed an issue of the magazine.
After the war, von Braun found a subscription rather easier to obtain when Operation Paperclip spirited the Nazi rocket team to the United States. They made their home in White Sands, New Mexico. The V-2 rockets that had terrorized England became the blueprint for America's principal weapon in the Cold War. But others had more idealistic visions for rocket science.
The cost of space travel is coming down substantially. Someday soon, we should all be able to get into space for the cost of a safari trip to Africa.
Yoji Kondo, space physicist, special assistant to the NASA administrator, and writer of science fiction under the name Eric Kotani.
As a youngster, I was reading newspapers, especially popular science magazines, in which there were reports of rocket experiments, V-2 rockets, being launched from White Sands in New Mexico by the von Braun team. And that was really an inspiring thing, especially after World War II, something to look forward to. Gave us dreams.
And those dreams reached their peak just 5 years after the war, with Destination Moon.
Claim it, Doc. I'm your witness. Claim it officially.
By the grace of God, and the name of the United States of America, I take possession of this planet on behalf of and for the benefit of all mankind.
Destination Moon was brought to Tokyo in 1950. I was 16 to 17. I lived in the city of Hitachi, which is about 100 miles to the northeast from Tokyo. And I wanted to see this movie so much that somehow I was able to put together funds to go to Tokyo. And it took a whole day to go, but it was an inspiring experience.
But despite considerable progress on missiles, many members of the scientific establishment still thought that spaceflight would remain science fiction. 6 years after Destination Moon, the British Astronomer Royal Sir Richard Woolley was asked for his comments.
What are your feelings about space travel?
Well, I think it's all right, actually. I don't think anybody will ever go anywhere. It's too expensive.
It took just 12 months for the Soviets to prove him wrong. On October 4th, 1957, Sputnik was orbiting an astonished Earth, and the space age had finally begun. It was just over a decade before science fiction's original dream was realized, and mankind took that one small step.
You got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes from Olympus.
For people who were born after the Eagle landed, it's difficult to imagine the impact of that moonwalk. It was a triumph of technology and imagination that touched almost every person on the planet. But our time will come. Beyond the moon, there are literally billions of worlds for us to explore. The only questions are when and how.
Project Daedalus taught us that interstellar flight is a real possibility. It's not just a speculation. The human race will cross the stars, even though it may not be until the middle of the 25th century. But it will happen just as surely as the human race crossed the Pacific.
Alan Bond, rocket engineer and designer extraordinaire.
In the early 1970s, it became apparent that the time was right to do a real engineering study of a starship. And it looked as though it was possible to design a probe which would do a one-way flight to the nearest stars. And that was how Project Daedalus came about. Despite the fact that it was actually a robot vehicle and only manned by two maintenance robots, it caught the public imagination, and a great many people volunteered to actually go on the first mission. Of course, it was a source of inspiration to a lot of people, just as in earlier days, Dan Dare in the Eagle had been an inspiration to a whole new generation of engineers.
Daedalus, with its nuclear pulse engine, was designed to travel at around 1,000 times the speed of the space shuttle. That's 10% of the speed of light. But even at this speed, Alpha Centauri, our nearest star system, would take 43 years. We're going to need something faster, Scotty. So what about antimatter? Envisaged in 1929 by British physicist Paul Dirac, matter and antimatter are assumed to be exact opposites, created simultaneously by the Big Bang. In theory, if one particle of antimatter collides with a similar particle of matter, they annihilate each other, releasing even more energy than a nuclear explosion. Earlier this year, scientists at the CERN laboratories in Geneva created the first 9 atoms of antimatter. They lasted for just 3/1000th of a millionth of a second. Yet plans for antimatter drives are already afoot.
Our antimatter propulsion system will get us to Mars round trip in 120 days, to Pluto in 3 years, and beyond in the order of 18 years to study our galaxy in great detail.
Professor Gerald Smith of Penn State University Laboratory for Elementary Particle Science. This is the man who's taming antimatter for use in space.
If we're going to do space science with antiprotons, we have to have a portable means of moving them from the production site to the launch pad and beyond into space. So we started to build and are well along in building a portable antiproton trap here at Penn State, which is in this laboratory.
The secret is first to catch the elusive antimatter. This steel trap ambushes the particles as they leave the gigantic accelerator at CERN and holds them in suspended animation. Then they're transported from Switzerland to the laboratories in the United States. Here, Professor Smith carries on his research into what he hopes may one day become a massively efficient antimatter drive. Long before Captain Kirk first switched on his warp drive, the potential of antimatter was explored by one of the early science fiction pioneers, Jack Williamson.
So far as I know, I was the pioneer in antimatter in fiction. I went to John Campbell, the editor of Astounding, with a notion for a series of stories about the planetary engineers who would terraform new worlds to make them suitable for human colonization or whatever. And he gave me a quick education in scientific possibility of antimatter and what it might be like. And it's given me quite a thrill to see it used to propel vessels in Star Trek and so forth.
One of the interesting legacies of Star Trek, for example, is that that particular spaceship was powered with antimatter. But the amount of antimatter that was used, I think it was a gram per second, is beyond conception. What we've done through basic physics experiments at CERN and Geneva, Switzerland, has demonstrated that, in fact, we can generate enough propulsive power for a very robust round trip to Mars in 120 days total, including a 30-day stop, with only a microgram, 1/1000th of a gram total.
Antimatter could take us to 30% of the speed of light. But if we could achieve 50%, we could get that trip to Alpha Centauri down to just 8 years. And one idea is space sailing, a technique that puts the ship back into starship. Just as the early explorers crossed the oceans with wind filling their sails, future pioneers could set sail for the stars, propelled by laser light from the sun.
I've come up with one idea of my own, and this is called beamed laser power propulsion. The basic idea is to have a large laser in orbit around the sun, collecting sunlight and turning it into laser light, which goes out to a sail. It's typically 100 to 1,000 kilometers in size, but it's made of very thin foil, and when the light from the laser bounces off of it, it gives it a little push. It is a very small push, but over the months and years, it builds up to where you can push a space vehicle carrying a large crew, let's say 20, 30 people, up to half the speed of light.
If 50% of the speed of light sounds like we're getting somewhere, it's worth remembering that even at this speed, a trip to a neighboring galaxy would take 4 million years. We're about to hit a fundamental problem to do with the laws of physics.
No matter how good the starships are that we come up with, we still have a problem, and that it seems like the universe has a built-in speed limit of the speed of light.
Now, this is where things start to get really weird. It was Einstein who argued that when objects reach these incredible speeds, time goes haywire. He predicted that one of the few things we've learned to rely on as unchanging would stretch like an elastic band. Half a century later, experiments proved him right.
I believe in 50 to 100 years, we will in fact have rockets that will take us near the speed of light, ion engines, photon engines. They'll take us to the speed of light where time itself begins to
slow down.
Professor Mikio Kaku at the City College of the University of New York, physicist, writer, and broadcaster.
One of the most preposterous predictions of Einstein's theory is that the faster a rocket moves, the slower time beats within that rocket ship. Imagine somebody taking off near the speed of light, and you're sitting on the Earth with a telescope. As you look in your telescope, looking at the rocket ship, you see that everyone inside is frozen in time because the rate at which time beats has actually slowed down. But we've actually measured this in the laboratory with atomic rockets, with satellites. We can actually measure the fact that time slows down the faster you move.
In 1975, Professor Carol Alley of the University of Maryland set out to test Einstein's theory with two synchronized atomic clocks. One was flown on board a military plane, while the other stayed behind on the ground. After the flight, the clocks were found to be ever so slightly different in the time they told. Time dilation is even more pronounced for the crews on long missions aboard the space station Mir. But what might have remained an obscure footnote in quantum physics could become the most fantastic element of our future in space. And once again, science fiction was the inspiration.
Carl Sagan, the noted astronomer, was writing a science fiction script called Contact, meeting extraterrestrial life forms. But he had a problem. The distance between stars is so great that it would take centuries to visit other planetary systems. And because of the time dilation problem, he decided to ask a physicist, is it possible to go these enormous distances in a twinkling of an eye?
Sagan called Professor Kip Thorne, a noted expert on Einstein's theory. Thorne struggled with the problem for some time. Then, in the back of a Ford Bronco, as he was driven along Interstate 5, he made one of the most inspiring connections of modern physics by linking Carl Sagan's cosmic conundrum with the exciting new concept of wormholes.
A wormhole is a hole in space that may give us a shortcut between two points. For example, if I had a super microscope and I could peer right into the fabric of space and time, I would find that it's not smooth at all. It's foamy. It's frothing with tiny little holes and bubbles. If science can somehow tease apart one of these holes in space, we could actually connect two distant regions of space and time. Now, where have you seen that before? In Alice in Wonderland's Through the Looking Glass, the wormhole was Alice's looking glass that connected the countryside of Oxford with Wonderland, such that when Alice stuck her hand through the looking glass, her hand went through the wormhole and came out on the other side of forever.
Thorne was triumphant. Wormholes were an exhilarating means of connecting two points in space. It was only later that the full implications hit him. If wormholes could cheat space, they could also cheat time.
It was disconcerting to see the sun arc in less than a minute.
To see a snail race by. My flowers flinging wide their petals to embrace the new day. And the hours speeding across the face of my sundial. And the flowers closing their eyes for the night. It was wonderful.
After years of fantasy, this incredible development allows us to imagine the impossible. Something that mainstream science had refused to consider. For the first time, we can dare to speculate on the workings of a practical, functioning time machine.
Now, this is not going to be like H.G. Wells' famous novel, The Time Machine, where you sit in a chair, have a bunch of blinking lights and dials and literally rocket hundreds of thousands of years into the future. That's not what it's going to look like. Let's go through the steps by which we physicists think you can actually build a time machine. First, on the planet Earth, build two gigantic metal plates and charge them up with fantastic amounts of energy. Step number two, right next to it, build a carbon copy, two parallel plates, and charge them up. And the Casimir effect will take place. A small wormhole will begin to open up between these two parallel plates. Now remember, the Casimir effect is not science fiction. We've actually observed the beginnings of the Casimir effect in the laboratory. Step number three, get a rocket ship. Put the carbon copy into the rocket ship and send that into outer space, leaving the first set of parallel plates on the Earth. A wormhole, an umbilical cord, will connect the parallel plates on the Earth with the parallel plates in the rocket ship. Step number four, as you approach the speed of light, time dilation occurs, time slows down, and these two parallel plates are no longer in synchronization with respect to space or time. And the last step, jump into the set of parallel plates on the Earth. You will immediately be sucked right through this umbilical cord to the other set of parallel plates existing in a different point in space and a different point in time.
The ability to skip forwards through time is one of our oldest fantasies and has launched a thousand adventures. Meeting our ancestors, our descendants, playing with history, committing the perfect crime, and getting rich quick. All these and more have been explored in books and films. But before we get too carried away, there is one tiny problem. To power your time machine, you'll need the energy of an exploding star. Nevertheless, there is a glimmer of hope. One day, time and space may cease to have meaning, the entire universe ours to explore, and at a time of our choosing. But the implications go way beyond time tourism. The instant science opens up a gateway to the future, the sum knowledge of the universe becomes ours virtually overnight.
For now, time travel is beyond our technology, but that may not always be the case. Space, however, is there for the taking, and the conquest of the moon will prove to be only the first of many milestones, both within our galaxy and beyond. Where the pioneers go, we will follow, and what is for now the privilege of astronauts alone will become our fantastic future.